Douglas Chapel. We're so glad you are here tonight. Wish everybody was here that ought to be here, but they're not. That's the way it usually is on every Sunday night. But just praise God he's here with us. That's the important thing. That's the important thing. Just looks good to see you. Just looks good to see you. We're going to begin our service tonight. Well, welcome in and out. Well, I welcome Jordan. Announcement wise, 7 o'clock tomorrow night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night. Special singing each night. I think John's probably going to sing at least one night. Maybe, who knows? We'll see.
Oh, he's already told us last night. Sean.
Well, I saw him this afternoon, so if I don't get any more this week, that'd be all. No, but anyway, I do want just wanted to make sure you had the invitation to sing anytime. Not coming up ahead here at the church over the next couple of months, so keep all that in your prayers. And again, I mentioned this morning, Lord willing, on Homecoming Sunday, October the 16th, I think the date is, Lord willing, we'll be having a baptism service to open our morning service.
Amen.
So I'm looking so forward to that. So just be much in prayer for that. We're going to get started by standing together and singing what I call a Free Will Baptist anthem, Victory in Jesus. It's on the screen. Prayer time in our service, and as we prepare to go to the Lord in prayer, we've got a lot to pray for and about and to be thankful for all at the same time. And there's a lot of sick people in this world that need prayers, folks. Not excluding a whole lot of fear, different things. So let's be much in prayer for each other all the time, that God's will be done in our lives, whatever it might be. Somebody this week, I don't remember who it was now, I had And Brother John used to work at the hospital some, so he knows, sometimes just speaking the name of Jesus to a patient makes a world of difference. And I had several come in. Not necessarily chaplain, but just nurses, doctors, others, and just praising the Lord. You know, and that's a great feeling. That's a great feeling. But it is prayer time, and I wonder if we have those we need to add to our prayer list tonight. Any others tonight? Yeah.
I'd like for us to remember Randy Turner. I went to school with him. He's now in a nursing home. He's suffering from problems.
Any others tonight? All those with silent requests. Brother Andrew, would you lead us to the throne of grace?
Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you tonight with humble hearts, and we just thank you, Lord, for allowing us back into your house tonight, Lord. And we just ask that you be with us here tonight, and just let the Holy Spirit just run through here and just give us all the revival that we need.
Yes, Lord.
And we just desperately ask for, Lord. We also come to you tonight, Lord, lifting up names that are in need of your special touch tonight, Lord. We ask that if it's in your will, Lord, just reach down to them, just bless them, Lord, and just heal them if they're sick or suffering, Lord. And just we just especially just ask that your will be done in each and every situation. And like I said, we just pray that you'll be with us here tonight, Lord, and just let everything that's done tonight be in accordance with your will. And all these things we ask in the precious name of Jesus, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. As usual, as we were trying to get things together for our revivals, I began looking singers. I always love to have special singing going on. And I don't know, probably maybe a day or two after I had mentioned that, I got a text from Brother Jody. He said, what did he call it? Potter's Mountain. Potter's Mountain Singers will sing on Sunday night. I texted back and said, I don't know them. He said, well, it's the horns, actually. I said, well, okay, then I'm going on. So without further ado, I'm going to invite our horns to come and give us what God's laid on their heart tonight. And I'm going to get right here and sit down and rest my knees a moment.
How y'all doing? Good. It does look a little better out here since the rest of the choir is off stage. But we're blessed to be here, guys. We're happy to be here. It's a truly blessing to be able to sing with my brother, my wife, and my sister-in-law. And we get along most of the time. Yeah, just me and Stacy, not, you know.
We get along just fine.
But we are blessed to be here. None of us really like singing in front of people, but we do it anyway because it's what the Lord's called us to do. So we're just going to try to muscle our way through a few songs tonight, and we hope that you guys receive a blessing. And let's see, am I on the right one?
Yeah.
The right one. Yeah. Okay. First one we're going to sing tonight is called "Dearest Friend."
And in the spirit of our acapella Sunday we do once a month, these are going to be all acapella except for the last one. We're going to get y'all to help us with it.
Yeah, we'll let y'all know when that one's ready to go. But, all right, y'all ready?
Yep.
When I was drifting out in sin,
sin.
I had no peace.
I had no peace.
No joy within.
No joy within.
But Jesus came.
But Jesus came.
And made me glad.
And made me glad.
The dearest friend.
The dearest friend I ever had.
He saved my soul.
He saved my soul.
Oh, bless his name.
Oh, bless his name.
I'll never forget.
I'll never forget.
The day he came.
The day he came. He makes me glad.
He makes me glad.
When I am sad.
When I am sad. The dearest friend.
The dearest friend I ever had.
When Jesus comes.
When Jesus comes.
The way is bright.
The way is bright.
For he's the way.
For he's the way.
The truth, the life.
The truth, the life.
He'll save your soul.
He'll save your soul.
And make you glad.
And make you glad.
The dearest friend.
The dearest friend I ever had.
He saved my soul.
He saved my soul.
Oh, bless his name.
Oh, bless his name.
I'll never forget.
I'll never forget.
The day he came.
The day he came. He makes me glad.
He makes me glad.
When I am sad.
When I am sad. The dearest friend.
The dearest friend I ever had.
Oh, sinner, come.
Oh, sinner, come.
To Jesus now.
To Jesus now.
At his dear feet.
At his dear feet.
Just humbly bow.
Just humbly bow.
He'll save your soul.
He'll save your soul.
And make you glad.
And make you glad.
The dearest friend
I ever had.
He saved my soul.
He saved my soul.
Oh, bless his name.
Oh, bless his name.
I'll never forget.
I'll never forget.
The day he came.
The day he came. He makes me glad.
He makes me glad.
When I am sad.
When I am sad. The dearest friend.
The dearest friend.
I ever.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
This next one is
Fishers of Men.
And I think, who was it that sang? Rhonda Vincent. Yeah, Rhonda Vincent sang it. And it's a beautiful song, beautiful song. And Danielle does a good job. I'm not going to build her up too much because she'll be mad at me.
You're right. All right.
Whenever you're ready, babe.
Rise and follow me. I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me. I'll make you fishers of men. Rise and follow me. I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me. I'll make you fishers of men. Peter, John, and James could never be the same. After they heard him say, I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me. I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me. I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me. I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me. I'll make you fishers of men. Cast your nets aside and join the battle tide. He will be your guide to make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me. I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me. I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me. I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
Jesus bore the cross to gather in the lost. Oh, what a mighty cost to set us free from sin.
He said,
rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me. I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me. I'll make you fishers of men.
Thank y'all. Throat is dry, and that's gonna be all right. Mm-hmm. This last one is called "I Can't Even Walk." I'm gonna do my best to get through it. And we'll just pray for us. Nobody look at me, Roger. You look at the floor. You don't look at me. I'm gonna turn around and face the wall. It's gonna be fine. It's gonna be all right.
It's gonna be wonderful.
Yep. I thought that number one would always be me. I thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I thought that I could do a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand. But I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
I think that I'll make Jesus my all in all. When I'm in trouble, on his name I'll call. And if I don't trust in him, I'd be less than a man. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand. Lord, I can't without you holding my hand.
Beautiful. I made it through that completely.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I want the first record.
You want the first record? Well, you may have to wait a minute on that. So if you guys look underneath your hymnals or on the back of the thing there, there's a piece of paper. It's got Living by Faith written on it. And it's got the sheet music for that. We're going to have you guys help us out on this last one, because I wasn't sure how we were going to be able to sing after that one. So as a safe bet, we're going to have all y'all singing with us too, just in case.
We're
going to
sing the first, second, and last.
Yep, so first, second, fourth. So you guys want to, you can stand up. We're going to sing Living by Faith.
Shadow or sunshine, oh man.
give yourself a hand. That was beautiful. Thank y'all.
Normally at this point, I have everybody stand. We do a little course just to stretch your legs, but we stretch them pretty good right there. So we're going to admit that one tonight. We might use it another night this week. But it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you, and most of you know him already, I'm sure. I don't know how many years I've known him. It's been a long time. Long time. Way before the Lord called you into the ministry, singing with Second Edition Quartet back then. I've grown to love him and admire him and appreciate him over the years, and have been looking forward to this week because I know the kind of messages that God has laid on his heart before and how he delivers them. So Brother John, come on, give us what the Lord's given you tonight. God bless you.
So good evening. Thank you for having me come and share with you tonight. It is a pleasure. It's been years since I've been here. John Mark Whaley was pastor here when I last came, and I'm glad to have the chance to be here. And I think I came with Second Edition, and we sang here one time. Anyway, it's been many things, many times, and I appreciate this opportunity. Thank you, brother, and thank you that you're here at all. Thank you. We've been praying. In fact, I text Beck when I was sitting there. I said, not only is he here, but he's leading worship. I was like, so we were sharing. But thank you all for coming out last night and enduring what we had to share. It was a real challenge. It's a challenge for us too, brother. I can promise you. I'm going to tell you, those guys, they ain't right. They're just not right. Okay, so but we have a blast. We have a lot of fun. Hosea chapter 6 verses 1 and 2. It's one of those Old Testament books that you probably have to look to the table of contents to remember where it's located there in those minor prophets of the Old Testament. But Hosea chapter 6 verses 1 and 2. I invite you just to listen to God's word. Come and let us return unto the Lord. For he hath torn, and he will heal us. He hath smitten, and he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us, and in the third day, he will raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. Let us pray. Father, you have arranged this moment many, many weeks and months ago. For me to be here and for all of us to be here, and of all the choices that we could have made, places that we could have been, we chose the right thing, which is to sit at your feet today. Yes. And we ask you, Lord, that in these moments, as we have already felt the Spirit through the choir singing, through the special music, through the prayers, and through just the loving countenance of one another, I pray that that abiding Spirit will continue to be here even with anything that I've got to say. So, Lord, this is your holy moment, and in Christ we pray. Amen. You know, I've been working on a variety of things since my main work is at the Free Will Baptist Press as the president of that organization and editor. And as I've been working with them and working with our Sunday school material and those things, that I ran across several important things that I tripped up over, and I realized that the Bible has many invitations, that God is calling us, inviting us to join him in different parts of our life. And I don't know about you at this moment, but I know that God is certainly calling every one of you, and through these few services that we have together, maybe one of these invitations will rest upon your heart. But when I think about those, I'm not going to go through all of them because there's so many. There's more than we have time to share in this series of services. But the first one's found over in Genesis chapter 7 when Noah is building the ark. And God invites Noah and his family to come into the ark that they might be saved from the flood. And that first offer of coming inside, come and join us. That's such a beautiful language. And then the final one that we find in the scripture from Revelation 22 verse 20 is that final invitation. And that is that calling, that invitation for the Holy Spirit to come quickly and to come and to receive us unto himself. And I believe that in all of these invitations, they're so important and they're some of my favorites. But when I think about those, maybe the one that we need to think of today is the one that came to somebody like Hosea. See, this passage, the prophet calls out the people of Israel. And you know that job of that prophet to speak the words and to call out sin, to call out people, but not always for something to condemn them, but to call them out for something good as well. And each of the prophets have those moments when they called for something good and called for something bad. But we hear in this passage, Hosea calls out to the people of Israel and he's challenging them because they have wandered so far away from God. And they have, Hosea is moved by that Spirit, inspired by the Spirit to preach this word. And he tells them to give them a call, to call them to come back to the Lord. Because they had turned away from him. They had turned away from worshiping Yahweh, the one true God, off to worshiping other idols, false gods, the false gods of the Canaanites. And this invitation comes over and over again and is calling them that they could repent of their sins and to turn their hearts back to the one and only true God. So verse 2 of the passage, the prophecy tells us that there was a future day. A future day that was coming when Israel would return to the Lord and he would heal them. He would restore them to a place of blessing. So I can tell you that today, this coming day, that when the Jewish people once again come face to face with the Lord. But that's going to be, could be in the next moment for all we know. But in these verses that were written some 2,500 years ago, they still have a message for every one of us. And all of these particular callings, these different invitations, if you will, come to us today just as if they were written, just as they were written then. They come to us freshly written for us. You see, America needs revival. Right, we need revival. We all agree with that. We know that our nation has drifted so far away from its religious roots. We come to this country that has seemed to give itself over to sin and evil at every corner, every turn. And as I think about all the things that our country has got going on, I realize that that God is calling us, begging us, pursuing us, wanting us to come and to follow him and to give our lives to him in repentance and redemption. Sure, America needs revival, but I can promise you that America's not going to see revival until we see revival within the churches of Jesus Christ filling our communities. I can promise you that America's never going to see revival until not only the churches experience it, but we experience it in our heart first and foremost. You see, we have to rekindle in us that spirit of revival, and Christ is calling us right now at this moment to come back to him to receive repentance and redemption. You see, the passage calls for God's people to humble themselves before God, to seek his face, to seek his forgiveness, to seek his restoration. And in doing so, this is an invitation to what I would say, the invitation to contrition. You know, it's one of those old words that we find in the King James Version of the Bible, contrition, a word that we don't hear very often in our time today. It's something that we probably don't want to participate in either. The word contrition means to have a sincere sorrow over our sin. To have a sincere and honest desire to repent of that sin. To know that where we have fallen, what we have done, where we have experienced brokenness, we have committed wrongdoings in God, and we have a divine sorrow, a true sorrow that we wish to get right with God. You see, there's a state of the heart that God honors, and it's the heart that is of contrite spirit. Scripture says in Psalm 34, verse 18, "The Lord is near to them that are of a broken heart, and saveth much as to be a contrite spirit." Goes on in the book of Psalms 51 verse 17. "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise." You see, in all the people of Israel and all of us here today, we must have this possession of a contrite heart. If we're ever going to experience a revival in our homes, in our churches, and in our land, it comes from God's people deciding here and now that we will have a contrite heart. Isaiah 57, 15, the Bible says, "For thus saith high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy places with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit." To revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. You see, God's desire is to revive that heart of all of us who are humble of mind and spirit, who decide that we're not going to be puffed up, as Paul says in throughout his letters, that we're going to be people that will live honestly and live in the power of God, that we will live with humble minds and hearts away from the idea of pride in our heart and sin that so easily tricks us into living these lives. You see, I think that this message one today is one that we need to hear and to be reminded of. It's always sort of the first night of revival. This is typically the topic that many times we wish to preach or to mention. We are living in a time of very little contrition at all. We're living in a time where very few people experience a real sorrow over sin. We act like sin is more like getting our name on the board. And when Pastor Ronnie writes our name on the board, or we get a check mark by it and another check mark, or maybe we get demerits in some way. The reality is that our sin grieves God. It grieves the Holy Spirit, and we see God's presence diminished in our life. One of the reasons we don't see the Spirit of God moving as much in people's lives is because they are unwilling to let go of the sin they have in their life so that God can fill them. They're unwilling to feel that sense of true contrition and sorrow. I don't know if you've ever had those experiences, but I have. I've had those moments when I thought, yeah, everything's good. Oh, this little old sin I got going on is not that important. This little sin over here that I like to keep tucked away, it's okay. It's my pet sin. It's just between me and that sin. It doesn't bother anybody. Doesn't hurt anybody. But I can promise you that when you have a true contrite spirit, when you have prayed that God would convict you of sin, you realize that that little sin that you've been holding on to is what's holding you back from being fully in the presence and in the power of God. Amen. And there have been times when I have knelt down at altars like this one. There have been times I've knelt by my bed. There's been times I've knelt by my recliner. There's been times that I have laid face down on the floor and I have prayed to God, save me and have mercy on me because I am a sinner. Save me from my sin. Save me from the stupidity that I have committed in my life because I want to be used by you. I can't preach this sermon. I can't sing this song. I can't even walk until I have asked for God to forgive me of my sin. Amen. Well, we're standing in the back. You want to know what preachers like us pray about? We're standing around holding hands. We're praying God would cleanse me from unrighteousness. Because I can't preach until the Spirit has forgiven me of my sin. I can't be a conduit of the Spirit until the Lord has cleansed me. I cannot be used by Him until He has cleansed me. When the foreign Christ gets on the bus, or second edition was on the bus, what we would do is sit around in that bus and we would pray and always pray that God would forgive us of our sins because we needed to be completely sold out to Him. We needed to be totally in His hands. And friends, if you're going to have a right relationship with Him today, you need to respond to the invitation of contrition. See, the scripture, getting to my main points, I got a little bitty ear. I'm not sure this is going to work. But we'll see. All right. But, you know, one thing I want you to see there in verse 1, the first part of verse 1, is God's plea to a wanton people. Wanton is another one of those old school words we don't hear anymore. Wanton means that deliberate and without provocation or reason, an extravagant living, or maybe undisciplined, unhinged, off the chain. This idea that this wanton faith, that I have no remorse, I have nothing in me that constrains my mind or my heart. I just go out doing whatever I want to, whenever I want to, saying what I want to, being with whoever I want to, doing what I want to, and there's absolutely no self-control in it. I see it all the time in churches. I see it in people's lives. I see it in universities. I see it in schools. See it on the news, see it in social media. You see constantly people who are filled with wanton lifestyles. See, the people of Israel had a very wanton lifestyle for themselves. The people of Israel had every reason to serve and to honor the Lord by what they were doing and what God had done for them. Over and over again, the prophets and all of them, Jesus and Paul, would always remind them of what God did for them. Remind them that He brought you out of bondage. He brought you through the wilderness. He brought you through the river, through the water. He brought you through all these other things. He gave you the Ten Commandments. He gave you the Spirit. He gave you everything. And yet you still live these undisciplined lifestyles. They were wanton people. They had no discipline in their lives, much less about their spiritual lives. You see, friends, that phrase of the scripture that I read while ago, "let us return." In other words, at one point they had that close relationship. At one point they had what they needed. At one point they knew the close, intimate relationship that they had with God. But yet because of their wanton life, they wandered astray. Like some kind of a sheep with their head down, just munching on the next blade of grass. And I don't know about you, but that's exactly the way I think when we talk about us being like sheep. That's what we do. We get so caught up in whatever's right in front of us, and we're just munching along, munching along, munching along. And before long, we look back and we've gone so far away from where the rest of the Lord has intended. We've wandered into our own place. We've wandered into our own field. We've wandered far away. There's a time when I believe that the people of Israel followed the law. They sought His face. They honored Him above all others. And now they were so far away from Him. They were so deep in sin. They were so far from the peaceful shore. They had gone so far away that they did not know that even their relationship with God had grown cold. Their love for Him was felt like it was strong. They thought that maybe everything was just right, but they learned that they were a wayward and a wicked people. And the condition that Hosea mentions here in chapter 6 and 7, the scripture tells us in chapter 6 that they were like a morning cloud or the early dew. Now, out here in this area, I'm sure first thing in the morning you get some nice thick fall going through and you can't see where you're going. You see, their devotion to God was like that early morning dew. We walk out in the morning and I look in my flower beds. I look across the grass. I look at things and I love how it sparkles when the lights hit. Looks like millions of jewels and gems laying out there in the gleam of the sun. But very soon, it burns all away and it's gone. Their devotion to God was shallow and it was temporary. They talked about getting right with God, but their repentance and their devotion was fleeting at best. In the New Testament, in the parable of the sower, we know that that's the seed that was sowed out on the rocky ground. That it sprang up quick, but it couldn't last because the sun would come out and it would burn it. You see, friends, we've got too many Christians in the church today who are those kind of people, who will choose to spring up fast. They'll show up today. They'll do these wonderful, great things. But when trial comes, when difficulty comes, when everything is challenging, then they want to buckle under. Now is the time for us to, they say, now we're just going to give up and wander away. Now for Christians, we have to put down deep roots to get through these seasons of difficulty that we're in. You need to build your ark now because there's coming a day when it's going to rain. You need to get out of that valley because I can promise you, you've got a mountain that's coming. You and I need to know that our faith cannot be like a morning cloud here today and gone tomorrow. Hosea chapter 7 goes on and he says they were like a heated oven. Like a heated oven. They would heat up to a maximum temperature during the night so they'd be ready to bake their cakes and their flour things and whatever the next morning. Israel burned with a passion for sin. They used words like adulterers and wickedness and wine, and they all bear these things out. They had a passion for the things of God, but yet they loved their sin more than they loved Him. You see, that's the problem with sin. It's not in your best interest. It will always take you farther than you want to go, cost you more than you want to pay, make you stay longer than you ever wanted to stay. I can promise you it will take you to a place where of nothing but brokenness, and it could very possibly lead you to a place of absolute death. But I can tell you today that those people were like a heated oven. It might have looked really nice, but they burned on the inside with that desire for sin. They loved their sin. They wanted to follow their sin. And that's what happens to wanton people. They love their sin. We see it all over social media, the news, and everything else today. I think people just get a kick out of seeing how much sin they can commit. We see people in their lives come up with all manner of ways, and you think, and I know I've been guilty of it too. I remember 20 years ago, I said, well, how bad could it be? God, 20 years ago, and look at where we are now. And dare we say today, how bad can it really get? Friends, we got a long way we could go. People are real creative when it comes to sin. People are real creative when it comes to ways to hurt other people. People are real creative when it comes to ways they can bring suffering onto other people's lives. You see, the Bible goes on in Hosea chapter 7. He talks more about this wanton people. And he says that they were half-baked cakes. You see, the people in their time, they would take the bread or whatever it is they wanted to cook. And they set it by the fire. And you would take it and you would turn it. And you would gradually move it around so that each side of the cake would get the right amount of heat. You see, Israel burned on her earthly side with sin and compromised with her enemies of God. You see, on one side, they were nothing but just weak nothing. Just mellow nothing. But on the other side, the sin that they have committed had burned them. Had burned them in some way, and they didn't realize it. You see, the Lord was saying that they are not cold, that they were cold and uncooked. They were not hot nor cold, as they say over in the book of Revelation. But that in that moment, they were guilty of the fact that they compromised. God wanted all of them, and they were only willing to give one half of them. Only willing to give one side of them. It goes on, and Israel says in verses 9 through 10, that Israel described as a man whose strength has ebbed away. And he's unaware that time has come and unaware of the age that has taken toll on his body. Israel lost their power with God and they weren't even aware of it. They didn't realize that their strength that was in the Lord had now ebbed away, and that all this happened just like Samson had no idea that when Delilah cut his hair, that all of that word, that strength of the Lord had departed from him. And it had departed from the nation of Israel. Dare I say that any of us have failed to realize that the power of God, because of our sin, has left us. I see too many churches that the power of God has departed. We know that word in the Hebrew, you may know because it was getting close to Halloween time. That word Ichabod for Ichabod Crane, right? That old story. That word Ichabod is a Hebrew word that means the glory of the Lord has departed. And I've walked out of so many churches, and Brother Ronnie, I remember Ray Wells, D. Eakes, myself, and a few others. We walked out of a church back in the Western Conference who had been going through a challenge, and we walked out, and one of the brothers in the room threw a hymnal across the room at someone else. Well, about that time, the Ray Wells, pastor, and he was working with a conference. He said, well, brother, I think that's sufficient that we can go ahead and close our meeting today. And so they closed the meeting and went ahead and got everybody out. And as we were walking out, he looked back at the door and he said, we're going to change the name to Ichabod Free Will Baptist Church. Because the glory of the Lord had left that place. And they were so caught up with their foolishness, so caught up with their sin, so caught up with their agendas, that they failed to realize that the Lord was no longer in that place. And could not understand why another booming, thriving congregation up the road was doing so well. The Lord had left them and gone to work with somebody else.
That's right.
You see, friends, we need to wake up and realize that the Spirit of the Lord is looking for a place to work. And we need to be people that are a part of His kingdom. We need to be a people that are a part of His work. He goes on the same chapter and he says that Israel was like a silly dove. Instead of looking at the Lord and trusting Him, they wanted to fly right back to Egypt for their help. They wanted to fly right back to Assyria for their help. But yet they listened to the Lord's prophets. If they had listened to the Lord's prophets, they would have known that these nations had failed the Lord. That these nations would fail them. And they would disobey God by making these covenants and promises with all these pagans and heathen nations. It goes on in the same chapter. Israel is like a deceitful bow. Meaning that they couldn't be trusted to serve the Lord with faithfulness. It was the reality that, you know, you get, and maybe we don't, maybe some of you bow hunt, I don't know if you do, but at least when we shoot that gun, we know that when the sight's off, we know that we haven't done what is true to always hit the mark. You see, they had a lying scope, and they didn't understand why they were missing the things that God had for them. You see, friends, the law of the scripture was so central to them, should have been to them. For us, the Spirit of God and the Word of God is central to us. And if we will not heed the Spirit, we will not glory in the name of the resurrected Christ. If we will not stand firm on His written Word, then our sights are off. And it deceives us into thinking that we're somehow hitting the mark. You see, they were fickle, a fickle people. You know, friends, I wonder, in every room, every place that we go these days, I wonder if there was a day when you felt closer to the Lord than you do today. I wonder if somewhere along your path, if you can remember a day when you can remember the things of God were more precious to you than they are now. I wonder if you can remember a time when this house was more important. I wonder if you remember a time when His Word was more important in your life than it is now. I wonder if there was a time when His business, His time spent with Him was more important than it is now. I wonder if the things that truly thrilled your soul with God, there was a time when it was better than it is now. You see, friends, we too can ask these questions of whether or not our devotion to God is shallow. Or whether we have a passion for sin rather than the passion for God. Or maybe we have compromised ourselves with the world. Or whether we have lost the power and the glory of God for the Lord in us. If we're like silly doves or silly animals that are flirting here and there, looking for every kind of source that we could find, but yet always missing the Lord. I wonder if we have our lives set, the sight truly set, where we can trust to hit the target with faithful living. You see, you might find yourself in that condition today. You might find yourself in that place, in that time when you feel broken. But friends, the scripture says that you don't have to live like that. The Word of God says you don't have to live so far and so far away from what God would have for you, but that you can come to Him with a right and a contrite heart. That your heart can again burn with a flame of passion for God. You can be a church that is on fire for God. You can be a person that is ready to teach, lead, and serve for God. You can get past all those difficulties and pains and realize that you can be in love with God again.
Amen.
You see, if you and I would do our part by responding to being a contrite people, we can come back home today. We can come back at this moment because God has a plan for us wayward people. That's the second thing I want you to know from the latter part of verse 1. God has a plan for those of us when we are wayward people. You see, the reason that Israel was interested in returning to the Lord is because of what it says in verse 1. It says the word torn means to rent, tear, to be torn to pieces. The word smitten means to be striped or slapped, beat or hurt. And so in those things, that describes very much the way that Israel had experienced the hand of God. They had chosen to walk away from God, and each time they had been disciplined. I don't know. I know there's a lot of folks in the world that might say, you know, we don't spank our children. You know, I tried that too with my children. We adopted three boys from Brazil. They're brothers. They came to live with us almost 9 years ago. And I said, you know, they've been through some real rough stuff. They've been through some broken times. They, you know, we're going to try to find all kinds of other means for discipline. And I think they tried every one of them. And I finally decided one day, and I'm not going to tell you the rest of that story, but the reality is that I didn't spank him. I tore him up. And I called my daddy because I was on the way to a preaching engagement. And I called him on the way to that church. And I said, Daddy, you always said it hurts me more than it hurts you. I said, that's a lie because it didn't hurt me at all. It didn't hurt me at all. He asked for it, and I knew it was what he needed. And that's exactly what I did. The nation of Israel was like that. You see, the nation of Israel had turned their back on God. And God had repeatedly, over and over again, torn, smitten, spanked, hurt them over and over again to try to get them to understand and to correct them as a good parent, as it would to their child. Hosea indicates that sin had become such a way of life in them that they didn't know that God was disciplining them. They had thought in their lives, they thought that all this stuff had been happened to them and that all this inflicting judgment, they maybe thought that God had hated them or something of that sort, but instead all of that discipline was for one thing, and that was because God loved them. You know, we discipline our children because we love them. We don't want them to turn out like those crazy people on the Maury show. We don't want our children to show up like the people on, you know, Jerry Springer. We don't want our kids to have to go on Dr. Phil. We want our families to be healthy and wealthy and wise. We want them to go out and contribute to society. We need them to stand in our churches. We need them to lead our worship. We need them to do our part in the kingdom of God. And so we discipline because we know it's right. God was disciplining the people of Israel because he was bringing upon them harsh judgment because of their disobedience. But you know what? He'll do the very same thing for us too. If we choose not to follow, if we choose to reject him, if we choose not to heed his word, I can promise you we will bring on our own destruction. Sometimes God says, I'm going to give you two options today. You're going to choose life or you're going to choose death. You're going to choose to walk by faith or not. You're going to choose to be with me or walk away from me. You're going to choose to be in relationship with me or turn your back on me. Which one do you want? And we have to get up every single day and choose Christ. That's right. To choose him as the center of all of the things that we love. That we love him more than we love sin. That we love him more than we do our little agendas and our plans. That we love him more than anything else in the world. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold or anything else, because all those things on this earth will amount to absolutely nothing. Those painful effects of chastisement and punishment can be clearly seen throughout many people in the Bible. And I don't have time, not going to take the time to go through all of them this evening. But I can tell you that somebody like David understood when King David had sinned deliberately, knowing full well that his pride and his sin, he refused to listen to God and to follow his way. And when he had sinned, he realized that he had to get on his face before God and to ask for forgiveness. You read about that in Psalm 51, his words and his prayer to God, asking for total forgiveness. You see, if you're a person today that needs that today, if you need that spirit of contrition, and you feel the Holy Spirit convicting you of sin today, and you say, well, John, I don't know what I need to say. I don't know what to pray. I don't know what to do. I don't know anything about it. I'm not even sure how to approach God. I've sinned so much, I don't know what to do. Maybe you can just take Psalm 51 and make that your prayer. Because I can tell you, if you need words, that's a good place to get it. If you've never confessed anything to Jesus Christ, if you've never asked Him to truly forgive you of your sins, you can look at that and you can find out exactly how to do it. Because David rekindled his relationship with God because of that punishment he went through. He knew that he had sinned against God and he wanted to get it right with Him again. You see, we need to understand this truth that you are never going to get away with sin. You are never going to let sin become something that will bless you. Sin will never, ever bring you to a place better than when you found it. It will never lead you to a place of life and goodness and wholeness. Never. It will always lead you to destruction. And you have to say, well, you know, it may not be tomorrow that it happens, but one day, one day the chickens will come home to roost. One day it's going to come back. One day it's going to come up if you don't handle it with God. There's many, many examples throughout the scripture, but the Lord tells us that if you want to make your life right, if you want the Spirit of God to be alive in your heart, if you want the Spirit of God to dwell in your home, if you want the Spirit of God to be active and alive and strengthening in every part of your life, then you need to follow that plan that He made for wayward people, and that's to ask for forgiveness. It means coming with a contrite heart and a contrite mind and bowing before Him and asking that you would be forgiven. But there's 3 points. Every good sermon has 3, right? That's right. At least 3. Better have at least 1. But I've heard some that I wasn't sure. But God's promise, He has a promise to wounded people. Okay, so He has a plan for those people that have a wanton heart. He has a plan for you to come back to Him. And God has a promise to us today. See, some people of this world are so foolish into thinking the same way that Israel thought. They seem to think that people are trying to make some type of religious formula. They're saying, you know, if we can act a certain way, if we can do certain things, that God was obliged to respond to us in some kind of manner. If I will just get the math right, then we will always get what we put out of it. If I can set the machine up right, we can put the product in one side and get something else on the end. You see, revival, we can have the services, you can find the preachers, you can have the singing, you can do everything you want to, you get all the formula right, but in the end, you didn't get it. Why didn't you get it? Because it did not start with a contrite mind and a humble mind and a contrite heart. We have to have a spirit that is willing for God to move in us so that He will change all that we are. It may be true that for us, there's a ray of hope here for all of us that maybe find ourselves drifting a little far out to sea. There's this ray of hope for us who might believe and know that our sin has come between us and the Lord. That Israel had suffered at the hand of the Lord, but if they will turn to Him, if they will return to Him with their whole heart, not just the side close to the heat, but with both sides of their heart, their intellect and their emotion, their works and their words, their right hand and their left, their mind and their heart. If they will come to God with their whole heart, then they will know and experience the healing that is possible to make things whole and healthy again. The word bind there is to tie up a wound, to take those scars that we have and to put the gauze over it, to bind that sprained ankle or that arm that's hurting, to bind it up and to hold it so that it can be healed. You see, if they would return to Him, God would minister to them personally. Not send angels, not send prophets or preachers, not any of that, but that God Himself would personally come to them and meet their needs quickly. He would restore them to a place of help and blessing. You see, according to the book of Genesis, when God created the heavens and the earth, God spoke and this happened. He spoke and that happened. He said something else and something else happened. But when it came to creating humanity, he got into the dirt himself with his own hand. He did not create humanity with a spoken word. He created it with his hand. He formed Adam out of the dirt and dust of the world and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. God is a God that personally wants to be involved in our lives. He wants to personally be involved in your day-to-day decisions. And he will personally be the one that will come and bind your wounds. He will personally come to take you out of the depths of sin and put your feet on solid ground. He will personally come in your life and change you and bring you to a place of blessing. If you will hear his voice, if you will realize that you have strayed from him, if you will commit to returning to him, he will restore your wholeness again. We need that blessing that's mentioned in that verse. Think about it for just a moment. If you think back to that verse, those who have been enduring God's chastisement need his healing. They need binding. And for those people that have so much of their life torn, or maybe they feel beaten up, they need him personally to come and to lay a hand on a shoulder, or to hold a hand and to offer that healing ministry in their life. You see, you can have that in your life today if you will come back to him. If you will come to him, he will treat you personally and serve you in whatever way in order that you might have healing. Each one of us today needs God to do in us what Israel expected him to do for them. We need to feel that sense of revival. We need to feel that sense that God will raise us up. We need to know that we will live in his sight. You know, those three things are the very essence of what it means to have true revival. That he gives us life. He causes us to stand up again. He causes us to walk in his presence. And when he's given us that, that is real revival. It's not an emotion. It's not an activity. But it's knowing that you will be brought back to life, to rekindle that fire, to raise you up and to live in his sight. More than anything else in this world, we need to come to a place where we know and have an honest conversation with God that our condition before God isn't what it ought to be. And friends, I'm going to tell you, if you're in this room, your relationship's not where it ought to be. There's not a single one of you that cannot be deeper in love with him. Amen. There's not a single one of you that cannot serve him more than you did yesterday. There's not a person in this room that has totally absolved everything of sin. And you're just great and wonderful. You're just clean in his sight. Scripture says that even your most righteous acts are as filthy rags. You see, friends, every single one of you in this room need a contrite heart. Every single one of you in this room, every one of us need to come to him and ask for revival. We need to ask that he would bind our wounds. We need to ask him to raise us up. We need to ask him that to let us live in his sight and his spirit. Friends, we're eager for him to come. And we're eager for him to restore. Now, we all see that we need revival. We know that we need revival in our churches. We need it in our nation. But more importantly, we need it in our personal life. The only way God is ever going to send real revival to us, real revival to this church, real revival to this community, is when we have heeded his call to humble ourselves before him in contrite heart, in contrition and broken-hearted repentance. Has the Lord spoken to you? Has the Lord spoke with you this morning in this morning service and even in this evening service that God has said somewhere in your life today, maybe this afternoon as you're sitting in your recliner, won't take a nap, whatever the case is, God is calling every one of you and he says to you, can you remember a time when we were closer? Can you remember a time when we were a little deeper in love with one another? Can you remember a time when everything was just right and you knew that your relationship was just humming along and you seemed in sync with God. The time when everything you put your hands to seemed to be blessed by God. Are you tired of a powerless life? Are you tired of God's efforts falling on dry ground? Are you tired of seeing how the world's going? Are you tired of seeing programs falling flat? Are you tired of feeling just flat and leaving worship with just no interest whatsoever? Wouldn't you like to have His blessing rather than His discipline? Then friends, come home. Let Him heal you and bind up your wounds. Let Him restore you to the joy of His salvation. Let Him give you the peace and the joy and the blessing that have squandered you so far out in that foreign country as the prodigal son. Come home. Lost friend, you can come to Him today. Are you tired of life? A life of sin, a life and you long for something more? Then come to Christ because He's calling you. You can be saved. You can be revived. But remember these words from Psalms. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. A broken and a contrite heart. O God, He will not despise. May we pray. God, I ask that today in this closing moments of this worship service, that all of us can handle our business with You. I pray, O Lord, that in these moments that I've done what You've asked me to do, but that all of us will do what You have asked us to do, and that we'll come home to You. Forgive us of our pride. Forgive us of our arrogance. Forgive us of our annoying sins that we seem to like. Forgive us for choosing the world rather than Your kingdom. So Jesus, come and receive us because we're coming home. In Christ we pray. Amen.
You have heard a wonderful message.
Amen.
Wonderful message. Now it's our turn to do something. It doesn't do a lot of good to hear a message. We're not going to do anything with it. So let's get our hymn books. Hymn number 57. Jesus is calling. He is truly calling. Let's stand together and sing. If you have a need, I invite you to come. I'll tell you, Miss Fanny Crosby could write a song, man. She could do that. attendance and your attention. If you haven't got a blessing, it's your own fault. I guarantee you that. Tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, Lord willing, Sister Carrie Jo Mazingo and Penny Carnegie will be with us singing, and looking forward to that. Always do, they do a great job. That will begin at 7. And so please be here with us. Just look around, and whoever's not here, call them and say, where are you? Where were you? And we'll continue this tomorrow night. Let's look to the Lord for our benediction. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your blessings upon us. We thank you for this time you've given us together again. We thank you for this wonderful message. Father, we pray your continued blessings upon us now as we depart one from another. Father, bring us back again at the next appointed time. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do pray. Amen and amen. God bless you.